Hello and welcome. I'm Uday Pratap Singh. You're joining us on this special interview on NewsX. We are in conversation today with Lieutenant General Dr. S.P. Kocher. He's Director General COAI. Welcome, General Kocher, to NewsX. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much.
Now, you've recently taken over, sir, as Director General of COAI after an illustrious career in the Army. What are going to be your key priorities and challenges, sir, in your tenure as COAI DG?
Well, like any other association, my first priority would be to see that the telecom sector expands and expands for the good of the citizen.
Mm-hmm.
We should be able to provide quality services at affordable prices to the citizen through our membership. I suppose that is the first objective that I have. And that more or less encompasses everything else. We would like to see that the government and the industry work hand in hand to achieve this objective.
Okay. As an industry body, of course, one of the roles is to take the problems of the industry, the key issues to government, so that they can sort it out, they can hear out the issues. What do you believe are some of the pressing issues today for the telecom industry?
So the most pressing issue at this point of time is a lack of deep pockets with the industry. Industry is bleeding, and whereas the requirement in the environment today is to roll out more networks, densify the networks, fiberize the networks, head towards 5G, so that we can give a realistic experience to the population, which is both affordable and which has good quality, and it is available when it is required. So that is the major problem that is facing the industry as of now.
Okay. How has been the government's response to some of the issues that you've raised and the COAI has raised with them? How has been their response?
So this is always an ongoing dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
So we present our viewpoint to the government and go back with the government's viewpoint to our membership.
Mm-hmm.
And then we parlay on these issues and then come to conclusions. Sometimes these conclusions are in consonance with what we desire. Sometimes there is a little give and take. And then finally, things keep moving.
Yes. If we talk about this year, it's been completely unprecedented. But, telecom has played a very important and integral role, in running the economy digitally over these last few months. What have been the key learnings, sir, over the last few months, and also some of the challenges that we put?
See, the key learning is that telecom is like water and electricity. The population now no longer can stay without telecommunication services. This is the most important key learning. The second key learning is then that when it comes to a crisis, the government and the industry work shoulder to shoulder and provide whatever is required to be provided to the population. And this is what happened in COVID. The industry rose to the occasion and kept the services alive, all types of services alive. It took on an additional load of almost 30% hike. And the government facilitated any roadblocks that were coming in the way. For example, keeping the power supply on, letting the telecom workers move freely.
Yeah.
That's another thing the government went out of its way to ensure that this happened. And with both of them putting their might, telecom services were never disrupted.
Mm-hmm. Where do you see the telecom industry currently and in the future ahead, sir? Considering the AGR decision also came out earlier this year, which is also something that was much awaited for the sector and the players.
Over the last 25 years, we have seen that the telecom industry has grown. It has grown from strength to strength.
Mm-hmm.
It is no longer a nascent industry. It is a mature industry. And telecommunications in today's world is, like I said earlier, an essential service. Telecom has become a foundational sector. And with Industry 4.0 coming in, IoT, AI, AR, VR, 5G has become mandatory, and therefore the industry has to now step into networks which support 5G.
Yeah.
Now to do that...
That leads me to my next question. Yes, for 5G, I think that's one of the most often discussed topics right now. What is needed on ground in the ecosystem to gear ourselves for 5G?
Yes. So what is needed in the ecosystem to gear ourselves, like you say, is... look at 5G as a separate technology. It is not an upgradation of 4G. had it been an upgradation and replacing boxes, it would have been easy. But it is no longer that. It is a new technology, hence it has to be looked at de novo. And the primary factors which propel the use case for rolling out 5G is the massive amount of data that is going to be generated, both by machines as well as humans.
Yeah.
And the entire capability of the industrial machine of India is going to depend on how we use this data.
Yeah.
So if for a moment if you see that the requisite type of networks of telecom are not available, then this data is resident from at the place where it is produced, and that doesn't give us too much of joy. But if a low latency, high capacity networks are available, which connect machines to me, and this is the first network. 5G is the first technology which is going to make machines talk to machines.
Yeah.
This has never happened earlier.
Yeah.
So see the humongous amount of data that is going to get produced and which needs to be transported. Now, the current networks have been built on a different mindset.
Okay.
The mindset is that roll out a network by using boxes and technology and then wait for applications to ride over. In 5G, this is not what is going to happen.
Okay.
5G is adaptive. And therefore, for each use case, a new solution has to be made.
Yeah.
And that is where the commercial people, the network people, the business people, and the top leadership possibly of each telco has to sit together and see what flavor of 5G and what tweaks 5G has to be rolled out in a particular territory, in a particular geography, in a particular use case.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the complexity of 5G. And I would say that while many may decry that we have missed the bus of 5G,
mm-hmm.
in a way it's good. Because in a way it's good that we are now going to roll out brownfield technology which has undergone the pangs of birth at different places
mm-hmm.
and has overcome most of the teething problems,
okay.
which otherwise we would have had to forbear with. At this point of time, we are at a stage where we understand this technology because of the world.
And especially because there are security challenges as well.
There are many challenges. Security is definitely one of them. But 5G per se by itself is a little more secure than 4G, which possibly is not very well understood. Yes, the connectivity is going to be very high. The use cases, the users are going to be very high. Data flows are going to be very high. But because of various architectural changes that have been brought about in 5G, security has been factored in to an extent. It is organic.
Okay.
But obviously, for every use case, security has to be beefed up. It has to be looked at totally differently. Security is not securing your laptop or your user. Security is really much, much, much more than that. And I think people who are working on this are quite aware of this. So these are some of the things that are going to see us.
Last word. I want your comment on a debate that's also been on, particularly on the spectrum band like ENV band and MM wave band, which the COAI is also pushing.
So this is a very good question. If we have to carry this aggregated data,
yeah.
and there'll be millions and millions of users, much more than you and I can imagine at this point of time. Now, this data will get aggregated to a site, and from there it has to be carried back home. And for such aggregated data, we require huge capacities with very low latency. Some of the problems can be resolved by fiberization. Most of the problems can be resolved by fiberization. But fiberization is an expensive proposition, both in terms of money and in terms of procedure. Okay, procedurally, the enablement of fiberization leaves much to be desired, and therefore, the government and we are working together, hand in hand, to see that it happens, especially as concerns ROW charges, as concerns various levies, etc., etc. But there will be cases where fiber in the air, if I may use that terminology, which has almost equal capacity as a fiber cable under the ground,
yeah.
will require to be rolled out because the connectivity is sparse,
okay.
and or it is difficult to lay fiber in those areas, or if the ROI does not permit fiber to be laid in that area, or there is flexibility required, so many causes. So
yes.
in that case, we will require EMV bands.
Okay.
Fortunately, in 5G, the access can also use this band. That means from the tower to the user.
Okay.
The same band can be used for forward communication as well as aggregated communication.
Okay.
Now, this is a very important factor, and it has not happened with any G earlier.
Okay.
And hence, we are saying, we are rooting that this is now a very,
okay.
Dear resource which needs to be given to users only and not be given to holders.
Okay.
And for that purpose, we are saying that it should be.
So that's the rationale. Okay.
That's
okay.
The rationale.
We leave it at that. We're out of time. My thanks to you. General Kochhar, for joining us and wishing you all the very best in your tenure ahead. Thank you for weighing in on some of the crucial issues concerning this sector.
Thank you so much. Thank you.